chat down below that will take you directly there to let us know that you're here. Let us know that you're worshiping with us. You can also just say hello in the Facebook stream or in the YouTube chat to let us know that you're here. We're really glad that you're joining us. And I want you to know that when we gathered this morning to prepare for worship, we prayed for you. We prayed for all of those that we were anticipating, were planning to come, would be led to come. And our prayer is that something will happen in this hour that we're gathered together in worship that will touch your heart. And we don't know if that will be in a prayer or in a song or in a time of quiet or through hearing scripture or the word proclaimed. But our prayer is that something will move in your heart that changes the direction of your life. And so just know that we've been praying for you. And if there's something that we could be praying about for you, a great way to let us know about that is by registering your attendance. There's a way to share prayer concerns with us. It's also a way to let us know if you would like someone from our staff to reach out to you. If you're in a place that you feel like you want someone to connect with you, that's a way to let us know. So we're really glad you're here. We're really glad to be worshiping together. And so let us begin that as we sing together.
Thank you. we're looking at the 23rd Psalm, we find words of comfort. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, indeed, this pandemic has caused loss of life. There is loss of jobs. The worldwide effect has been catastrophic. And yet, we who have faith in Jesus Christ know that the Lord is our shepherd. We shall not want. The Lord takes care of us. The Lord will lead us through this valley of the shadow of death. We will now sing a word of comfort in the song, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. We'll be led by the chancel choir and organ and instruments. Let us join our voices together as we sing this prayer, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us.
History and of our hearts, so much has happened to us during these whirlwind days. We've known death and birth. We've been brave and scared. We've hurt and we've helped. We've been honest and we've lied. We've destroyed and we've created. We've been with people. We've been lonely. We've laughed and we've cried. Lord, you know our tender hearts and our frayed histories, and now another day begins. Oh God, help us to believe in beginnings and in our beginning again, no matter how often we failed before. Help us to make beginnings, to begin going out of our weary minds and into fresh dreams. Help us to be a beginning to others, to be a singer to the songless, a storyteller to the aimless, a befriender of the friendless, to become a beginning of hope for the despairing, of assurance for the doubting, of reconciliation for the divided, to become a beginning of freedom for the oppressed, of comfort for the sorrowing, of friendship for the forgotten, to become a beginning of beauty for the forlorn, of sweetness for the soured, of gentleness for the angry, of wholeness for the broken, of peace for the frightened and violent of the earth. Oh God, help us to believe in beginnings, to make a beginning, to be a beginning, so that we may not just grow old, but may grow new each day of this wild, amazing life you call us to live with the passion of Jesus Christ, who taught all his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
My favorite thing about my mom is her cooking.
My favorite thing about my mom is that she's nice.
Hey, Ethan, what's your favorite thing about your mom?
That she cares about me.
Okay.
All right, Lachlan, what's your favorite thing about your mom?
Hugging her.
My favorite thing about my mom is that she's kind. And whenever I'm feeling down, she helps me feel better.
My favorite thing about my mom is no matter how busy it is at work, she'll always make time to spend with me.
She gives me recommendations for my books that I read.
Her good chicken.
My favorite thing about my mom is that she always does things that she doesn't want to do, but then she does it with me.
My favorite thing about my mom is that she cooks good food and that she made us.
She wrestles with me, she comes to my baseball games, she supports me, and yeah.
My mom is, she keeps me healthy by feeding me good foods and helping me whenever I'm sick.
My favorite thing about my mom is that she is always happy.
Mom is special because she plays with me.
My mom is special because she is my mom.
My mom is special because?
My mom is special because she does everything for me.
Mom is special to me because she spends time with me and cares about me and how she makes sure that I'm raised right and know what's right and what is wrong.
Mom is special because she supports me in all my activities and what I want to be when I grow up.
Mom is special because she makes me happy whenever I'm sad.
She's special because she, even though she had her heart, so she couldn't have the baby, she still wanted us.
My mom is special because she makes breakfast for us.
My mom's special because she always is happy and joyful.
Mom is special because she is always fun to have.
My mom is special because she takes care of me.
You say, my mom is special because
she loves me.
Why is your mom special?
Because she has a really good singing voice.
Is there anything that makes her special because of it?
Because she's my mom.
Because she's your mom?
Yes.
Your mom, did you say?
Yes.
Lyndon, why is your mom special?
Because I love her.
And what is your favorite memory with your mom?
I draw her pictures.
That is a good memory. I love you.
Bye, Anna.
What's your favorite memory with your mom?
Going kayaking with them on vacation.
Nathan, what is your favorite memory of mom?
Favorite memory of my mom is probably the first time we fell asleep on the couch together, because I felt like it was some special me time with mom.
When she gave me this painting.
My favorite memory about my mom is when, on my last birthday when I was turning 5, we went to go get our nails done.
My favorite memory of my mom is when she let me drive a tractor.
My favorite memory with my mom is we went to Cracker Barrel together. I love you, Mom.
My favorite thing about my mom is when I need her help, she'll always stop what she's doing and help me.
My favorite memory with my mom is a time when we make the cake together.
Mom's special because she's the biggest role model in my life and I really look up to her. She's always there when I need her, and she's always so happy, and she's always beside me, feeling gloomy or down, or things just aren't going well. She always helps me. Thank you so much, Mom.
Trouble now, I thought, how do we ever get so far down, and how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did, yeah. I created you. Now listen. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right now. Well, it's time for us to do something. So tired of talking about how we are God's hands and feet, but it's easier to say than to be. Live like angels of apathy, we'll tell ourselves it's alright, somebody else will do something. Sick and tired of life with no desire. I don't want to blame, I want to fire. I want to be the one who stands up and says, I'm gonna do something. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right
livable to live in, and I can't thank them enough for what all they have done for me. And I'm blessed. I'm truly blessed. Thank you. Changing the world.
And it's amazing. The work that's done was born right here in this church in 2012, and we're going to continue to do something. We have teams that'll be going out. We have food that will be packaged. All these amazing projects that will begin this kickoff weekend, this next weekend, starting May 14th. You can go to changetheworldallen.org to find out more. But ministry to our neighbors, loving folks around the world and changing the world for the better happens because of generosity of folks like you. People who decide that whatever amount it may be, they want to be a part of doing something. They want to go out and help their neighbors, or they want to fund those who can do the fence raising that maybe they're not able to do at this point in their lives. So there are lots of ways that you can continue to support great mission and ministry like Change the World. You can go on our website. You can text to give. I know that our vendor who provides the platform for giving sometimes gets swamped on Sunday morning, and that is a great problem. So if you've gone online and tried to set up giving and haven't been able to access it on Sunday morning, there's this great thing called automatic recurrent giving. You can set it and forget it and just know that you're continuing to support great mission and ministry, whether you remember to write your check, whether you remember to mail something, whether you remember to go on and make that donation or not. So I invite us to continue to worship God and express our gratitude to God through our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings as we continue in worship.
Over me, for all the days. Would you pray with me and for me? Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts of all of us gathered here in this moment, may they be pleasing to you. For God, you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So this morning, we're continuing in our worship series that we're calling Still Better Together. It comes out of an awareness that even though we are, most of us, physically distanced in this time, we know that as people who call ourselves Jesus followers, we are still better together. And one of the ways that we can be better together is as we share what's going on in our lives, share where we're being challenged, share where we're finding joy, share what's encouraging us. And as we did last week, I want to invite you in this moment. Maybe you're worshiping with other people in your home, and you can share with them one thing that encouraged you this past week. Or if you're by yourself and able to comment on Facebook, put that in the chat. Or if you have navigated over to YouTube, you can put that in the comments as well. What has encouraged you this week? I know one of the things that encourages me is when people share with me scriptures that are important to them. And that's why as we've been moving through this worship series, we have been focusing on scriptures that people in this church family have identified as being important to them. Scriptures that they've come back to time and time again in their lives that have brought them encouragement. And our scripture reading for today, interestingly enough, is one that was identified during a survey that was done by the Luther Seminary in St. Paul a couple of years ago. And they asked 1,500 people, what biblical text has been important to you in your life? And 15% of those who responded chose Psalm 23. So I have experienced that this is an important scripture for lots of people as I have presided at funerals and memorial services, because many people, whether it's the family of the person that we're celebrating or the person who has died, whose life we're celebrating, identify Psalm 23 as something they want read at that service. And it's always interesting to me how many people gathered in that service are able to recite from memory the King James Version of Psalm 23. I think what we find is that whether people know the Bible or not, many people know phrases, know this particular writing from our Bible. It's probably one of the most well-known and beloved passages of Scripture out of our entire Bible. And so maybe it's yours. Maybe you will resonate with the words of Psalm 23 as we hear them read by Ruth Swingle.
Today's scripture comes from Psalm 23, New Revised Standard Version. Listen now for the word of God. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Three is a psalm full of hope and reassurance. But it's very interesting to pay attention to the psalm that immediately precedes Psalm 23. That's Psalm 22. And Psalm 22 is a psalm of lament. It voices the community crying out, surrounded by enemies whose life is disappearing. And Psalm 22 is the psalm that Jesus quotes on the cross when he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He calls out in lament. Now, lament is not a word we use commonly in Western culture. And in fact, if we use it, we sometimes confuse it with complaint. But a lament is different from a complaint. The dictionary defines the word lament as feeling or expressing sorrow or grief. Now, lament is not only a word that we don't use very often in Western culture, it's also an act that is not common in Western culture because we in Western culture, we don't know how to do grief very well. We struggle with expressing it. And in fact, I think in the West, oftentimes when we feel those strong feelings of sorrow or grief, we try to move past them. We try to push them down. We don't want to acknowledge them. We sometimes even try to bury them in work or entertainment or a pint of ice cream. But these are strong emotions that God has given us. They are strong emotions that are expressed in the Psalms of Lament. And because they are there, we know that they are appropriate for us to feel. They are important for us to feel. And I want to suggest that there's plenty around us happening in these days that can bring up those strong emotions of sorrow and grief that can cause us to lament. And lament is not just for us when we are suffering. Lament is also for others who are suffering. And showing love for our neighbor happens when we acknowledge their suffering and allow their suffering to be a part of our prayers to God. So I wonder if you're able to name in your life today where you are feeling lament. It may be hard for you to put words to. But if you have words for that and you feel comfortable sharing that with the people that you're worshiping with, maybe you're in your home and you're gathered with family and that feels like a safe place, I invite you to talk about what you are feeling lament for. Or if you feel like putting something out there on the Facebook chat is a safe place for you, you can do that there. I want to share with you where I am lamenting. I lament for my children who did not get to experience this spring quarter of the semester, of the school year, when so many wonderful things happen. I lament for the teachers who did not get to say goodbye to their beloved students. I lament for the high school seniors and the college seniors and their families who have not gotten to experience the celebration of this significant milestone of graduation in the way they expected to, and who also look at the future and have no idea what it holds. I lament for families who have not been able to be with loved ones as they have been ill in hospitals and nursing homes, and who have not been able to be with them as they die. I lament that this pandemic has caused us to be afraid of each other, so that when I'm out taking a walk and someone is coming toward me on the path, I intentionally step off the path in order to make sure that we don't come too close to each other. I lament that rather than the people of this world coming together as one in our response to this pandemic, we are still, and maybe even more, sharply divided. I lament that it took public outcry over a leaked video of two white men shooting Ahmaud Arbery as he jogged in a neighborhood for justice to begin to happen. I lament that the deep sin of racism still rises up and is perpetuated by systems of privilege. I lament for any mother on this Mother's Day who has had to bury her child, but especially I lament for Ahmaud's mother. I wonder, what are you lamenting this day? Psalms of lament have three distinct characteristics. One is a crying out to God. The second is asking for help. And the third is a response of trust and praise. Now, what's interesting about Psalm 22, this Psalm of lament does not have a response of trust and praise. And that's why most scholars say that Psalm 22 and Psalm 23 go together, because Psalm 23 is full of words of trust and praise. The psalmist is filled with trust and praise, even as they acknowledge that they have been through a difficult season, as they speak of walking through the valley of the shadow of death. The Hebrew word there is psalmoeth. And most times, Psalm 23 translates this as the shadow of death. Now, this is a word that you might be familiar with because we talked about it back in December. The same word is used in Isaiah 9, which says this: the people who walk in darkness have seen a great light. Those who live in a land of deep darkness, that's psalmoeth, on them a light has shined. So this word can be translated as a shadow or a shade of death or a deepest darkness. And so the psalmist is using this word here to express the experience of walking through a time that is filled with deep, deep darkness that feels like death. And maybe you've been in a place like that. Maybe you feel like that now. Maybe you bring that even to this familiar psalm today. So last week, Austin New Church in Austin, their worship focus was Psalm 23, and they produced a video where this psalm is experienced along with some of the feelings of death and darkness that we may bring to it. Jessica Wright found this video earlier this week, and we offer it to you that perhaps it might express where you are today.
Psalm 23.
And me.
The Lord is my shepherd. I lack
toilet paper.
Answers.
Work.
Childcare.
Patience.
Hope.
I lack less than many,
but more than I'm used to. Lots.
I lack nothing.
Okay, I feel like you're not...
I feel socially distant from my shepherd.
He makes me lie down.
I'm fine on my feet.
He makes me lie down.
You can't catch me.
He makes me lie down.
But this article and that article and...
He makes me lie down.
I feel dizzy.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul.
Even if
my soul is spinning?
He leads me in right paths. For his name's sake.
Right paths like safe paths?
Even though I walk through the valley of...
Never mind.
Even though I walk through the valley of...
Unplanning.
Undoing.
Goals on hold.
Dreams delayed.
Lost memories.
Lost landmarks.
No work.
Overwork.
Even though...
The illness.
Even though...
The stuckness.
Even though...
The magnitude.
The terror.
The heartbreak.
The valley of the shadow of death.
Exactly.
I will fear. No evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
My robe and my sweats.
My routine and my schedule.
My robots and snacks.
They comfort me.
Your rod and your staff? I don't know.
New metaphor.
You prepare a table in the presence of my
doubt,
fear,
grief.
My enemies, you anoint my head with
Purell?
Oil.
These are old words.
My cup overflows.
Sometimes you feel so far away.
Surely goodness and love will pursue me all the days of my life.
Seems unlikely. That goodness and love will pursue me all the days of my life.
I mean, fingers crossed.
Surely.
Goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life.
And?
And I will dwell in my house forever?
And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Of this idea of goodness and mercy pursuing us. The Hebrew word there is radaf, and you can see that it means to be behind, to follow after, to pursue, to persecute, to run. Persecute would fit with the enemies that are around the psalmist as the psalmist sits at the table. And persecute has that idea of an intensity of someone coming after the psalmist in order to cause them harm. But that's not how that's used here. Nor is it used in the way of thinking about something following far behind. There's an intentionality of this word of pursuing, of running after the psalmist. It reminds me of the mother who runs after her toddler to try to catch the toddler before she runs out into the street or falls off the step. And on this Mother's Day, it seems to me that if we look carefully, we see several feminine images for God in this psalm. Now, sometimes it's hard for us to think about God having feminine attributes because of maybe the way we've been raised and the images that have been stirred into our understanding of God. But I want to share with you one of my favorite paintings, and it's actually one of Rusty King's favorite paintings, and he's someone who pointed this out to me. This is Rembrandt's Return of the Prodigal. And so if you see this, you see the painting, and you see that on the left, on the right, there is the elder brother looking on in disapproval. And there on the left is the father with the prodigal kneeling before the father as the father welcomes the prodigal home. And you notice that the prodigal's head looks like it's been shaved, and the prodigal's clothes are in tatters, and The prodigal's left foot is bare, and the sandal on the right foot is worn out. And all the light is on the father, and particularly the light is on the father's hands, drawing our attention, drawing everyone's attention to the hands. And so if you look at this close-up of the hands, can we go to that next one, the close-up? You'll notice the two hands are very different. The hand on, that is the left hand of the father, is square and large and almost masculine, and the hand on the right is smaller and more delicate and almost feminine. It's almost as though Rembrandt is wanting us to see both mothering and fathering going on here. Rembrandt is wanting us to see both the mothering and fathering aspects of God. So as we are looking at this psalm on Mother's Day, I want us to see the feminine aspects of God that are here in this psalm. You know, shepherding, as the psalmist describes it, well, shepherding was not women's work in those days, but shepherding was hard work, and it was constant work. And here, as the psalmist describes the work of the shepherd, it's constant, it's leading, it's guiding, it's reassuring, it's comforting, it's preparing a meal, it's anointing. And I don't know about you, but that sounds like the work of a lot of the moms that I know. That it's constant. It's the work of lots of people I know who create a place of safety and peace for the people in their presence. It's the single dads who work from home in order to be present to their children. It's the aunt who is the safe place for her nephew. It's the teacher whose drawers are always full of snacks for the kids who come to school hungry. It's all those who create a place of peace and safety for those who come into their presence. So from the time my mom married my dad in 1956 until she died in the summer of 2018, my mom lived in 12 different houses as a Methodist preacher's spouse. And seven of those houses were houses that I lived in too. But after I grew up and left home, my mom lived in four other different houses that I didn't live in. But what I experienced every time I went to the place where my mother was living, it felt like home. It was calm and peaceful and quiet, a place where I could breathe deep, even if life was really hard and challenging for me. It was a place of peace for me. And maybe your mother's house is or was like that for you. Maybe not. Maybe you know a place like that. Maybe that's the house that you have, that you've created a space for that. Or maybe you're longing for a space like that. I want to say to you today what this psalm of trust tells us in the end, that God promises a place like that for us in God. The psalm closes with the words, "I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." It can also be translated, "I will return to the house of the Lord all the days of my life." And God promises that in God's house, we can know peace. We can know hope. We can breathe deep even in the midst of chaos and uncertainty. These are the words of hope and assurance that we have in Psalm 23. Glory to God. Amen.
What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul for which long I have sought since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart.
So friends, I hope that you have been blessed by worship this morning, by being connected virtually to the community that is First United Methodist Church of Allen. Just a reminder, if you've not yet navigated over to our page to register your attendance, I encourage you to do that. And that is a place to indicate if you want someone from our staff to reach out to you, if something is going on in your life that you are longing for, a touch of pastoral care, that's a way to do that. Also want to remind you or invite you to a new ministry that we're offering, a virtual class that will begin on Wednesday, led by the Reverend Brian Hardesty Crouch, who is a spiritual director and a teacher of prayer practices, praying through the pandemic. And there's an opportunity to register ahead of time for that. That will be a Zoom class. Hope that you'll consider coming and being a part of that on Wednesday evening. And also, I am so excited about Change the World. I've gone ahead and I put my shirt on. We are going to be beginning and launching our Change the World Allen this weekend, beginning with Kids Against Hunger on Thursday. There will be opportunities for you to sign up to come and be a part of packaging meals for Kids Against Hunger. I hope that you will check out those opportunities on changetheworldallen.org. There will be other opportunities as well, but that is coming up. I'm very excited about that because I get to be a part of it. But for now, my friends, as you go from this time together, I encourage you to be aware of the people around you, knowing that we may be moving out in the world, and I want to encourage you to wear your mask, not because you're afraid, but because you want to care for others in this world. So now, go from this place to sin no more, to love God, to love and serve all of God's children. Go in peace. Shalom.
Thank you.